We're going to see the pituitary gland and its regulation. Pituitary gland has the adenohypophysis and neurohypophysis. The adenohypophysis is the anterior pituitary, and the neurohypophysis is posterior pituitary. The regulation is by the hypothalamus, just that the regulation to adenohypophysis is hypothalamus produces hormones that increases or decreases the release of hormones in the adenohypophysis. And for the neurohypophysis, the hypothalamus produces hormones that are stored in the posterior pituitary. The posterior pituitary doesn't produce anything. So here we have the nucleus of the hypothalamus are preoptic, paraventricular, and arcuate. Well, that we are concerned in this section of endocrinology. The arcuate nucleus produces dopamine and growth hormone releasing hormone. Paraventricular nucleus produces corticotropin releasing hormone, tirotropin releasing hormone, somatostatin, antidiuretic hormone, well, a little bit of antidiuretic hormone, and oxytocin. Preoptic nucleus produces gonadotropin releasing hormone, and I forgot one, supraoptic, this produces antidiuretic hormone and a little bit of oxytocin. Now, the oxytocin and antidiuretic hormone are produced by the hypothalamus and through exoplasmic flow and the nephrocytes that are the proteins that carry these antidiuretic hormone and oxytocin go into the neurohypophysis and are stored there. These are the Herring bodies. Oxytocin is almacened in its storage in Herring bodies. These cells that are in the supraoptic nucleus or paraventricular nucleus that produce antidiuretic hormone are called magnocellular neurons. Now, the preoptic nucleus that produces gonadotropin releasing hormones, this hormone goes into the adenohypophysis and increases the gonadotropin hormones that are FSH and LH. So adenohypophysis releases FSH and LH. Corticotropin releasing hormone stimulates the pituitary gland to produce the ACTH. Tirotropin releasing hormone stimulates pituitary gland to produce tirotropin, TSH. Somatostatin inhibits the release of TSH. So there is inhibition. Gonadotropin releasing hormone stimulates the pituitary gland to produce growth hormone. And somatostatin also inhibits the release of growth hormone. Dopamine inhibits the release of prolactin. And prolactin is also stimulated by TRH. Now, the adenohypophysis has basophils, acidophils, and chromophobes. The chromophobes doesn't stain nor orange nor purple. At the beginning doesn't, after they release the granules, yes, they become acidophils and basophils. Now, the acidophils are those that contain the growth hormone and prolactin. And the basophils contain FSH, LH, TSH, and ACTH. The glycoproteins are FSH, LH, and TSH. And the somatomammotropins are those that are released in the acidophil cells, growth hormone and prolactin. Now, ACTH is produced together with propiomelanocortin, from propiomelanocortin that produce ACTH, corticotropin, and MSH. MSH is melanocyte-stimulating hormone, but also beta-endorphins and beta-lipoprotein. These proteins are all together and very later they are cleaved. Now, deregulation, we already talked about deregulation in the anterior pituitary gland, but for the posterior pituitary gland, well, the oxytocin only produces, the myometrium contraction and the myoepithelial cell contraction that leads to let down of milk. The antidiuretic hormone is released in response to high osmolarity or decrease in blood volume, but is more sensitive to osmolarity changes as opposed to renin-angiotensin aldosterone system that with total changes in volume is increased that system. Also, angiotensin is going to increase the release of antidiuretic hormone. The deregulation is in the organum vasculosum of lamina terminalis, that is a organ of the brain that doesn't contain blood-brain barrier and sense the osmolarity. If sense higher osmolarity, will go or send signal to the paraventricular and supraoptic. Here will be mainly the supraoptic nucleus, and so there is release of antidiuretic hormone. Also, the antidiuretic hormone release is increased when there is decreased firing of the baroreceptors. Remember that the baroreceptors in the carotid sinus or aortic arch sense the desensibility. So if they are not feeling the desensibility, that is we have decreased blood, so or vascular volume. So they are not firing because the firing is parasympathetic firing. So they will not be firing, and so we will have sympathetic activity because there will be no parasympathetic opposition. So when we have decreased volume, decreased firing, there is increase of antidiuretic hormone, we absorb water, etc. The antidiuretic hormone is inhibited by alcohol. Remember, the alcohol will lose hypotonic solution due to the inhibition of antidiuretic hormone. So the patient is losing water, and so in a Darrow-Janet diagram, we have the extracellular space. Here's the extracellular space. This is intracellular space. This is the osmolarity. A patient that is losing hypotonic solution will lose solution, so decrease in the extracellular volume. Because it's hypotonic solution, there will be an increase in the osmolarity. And due to this increase in osmolarity, intracellular volume, well, intracellular water goes to the extracellular space, is not compensating the loss of volume, but will increase the osmolarity in the intracellular space. So this will be the diagram, this will be the Darrow-Janet diagram for a patient taking alcohol that inhibits the antidiuretic hormone secretion. Now remember that transference of antidiuretic hormone would be syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone secretion produced by mainly drugs like SSRI, carbamazepine, vincristine, vinblastine, tricyclic antidepressive, etc. Carbamazepine, etc. And diabetes insipidus in this case will be central. But if we damage the stalk of the pituitary gland, we have a triphasic state. First, diabetic insipidus, next, syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone secretion, and lastly, again, diabetes insipidus.